The term cult refers to a social group defined by its religious, spiritual, or philosophical beliefs, or its common interest in a particular personality, object, or goal. Religions tend to follow beliefs that are published openly in books such as the Bible, Quran, or Bhagavad Gita, whereas a cult relies on secret knowledge revealed only to members by the cult's founder and leader. In a cult, everything depends on a personal relationship between the founder and his or her followers, who are required to separate themselves from the rest of the world, often being bound to prophecies with a dark apocalyptic ending. That's what we'll investigate today in this episode of the Infographics Show, What Really Happened in Waco, Texas. April this year marked the 25th anniversary of one of the strangest and most tragic incidents in American religious history, when a bloody siege ended between FBI agents and members of the Branch Davidian religious group in Waco, Texas. The siege had dragged on for 51 days, and during that time, the FBI negotiators had continued to seek an agreement with sect leader David Koresh. 33-year-old Koresh, born Vernon Wayne Howell, came from a dysfunctional family background. Koresh told the FBI during the late-night negotiation chats that he was a lonely child teased by other kids who called him Vernie. But to himself and to his followers in the Branch Davidian sect, Koresh was the almighty Lamb of God, commanding men to surrender their wives to him, fathering babies with girls as young as 12, and preparing his followers for the imminent apocalypse. While Koresh was the leader of the cult, the story of the Davidians begins several decades before his ascent to leadership. The group, also known as Shepherd's Rod, is an offshoot of the Seventh-day Adventists, a Christian religious group that today boasts roughly 19 million members worldwide. Unlike regular Christians, though, they believe that the Messiah prophesied in the biblical book of Isaiah was not Jesus, but was yet to come, as was the apocalypse. After 51 days, the FBI's negotiations had hit a wall, with Koresh responding with everything from cracking jokes to threatening to start World War III, and much of it delivered using the scriptures, in particular the Book of Revelation. On the morning of Monday, April 19, 1993, with the FBI team still divided about whether negotiation could succeed, they eventually gave in and decided force was the best way to end the siege. Several hours were spent firing military-grade tear gas into the building before FBI armored vehicles moved in. Things took a turn for the worse just after noon, when the main building was engulfed in flames. Strong winds saw the fire spread fast, and the flames destroyed the biblically named Mount Carmel Center, part of the Davidians' compound. Byron Sage, head of the FBI negotiating team in Waco, called over the loudspeaker system, "You know, David, don't do this to those people. This is not the way to end this." But on that fateful day, 76 Davidians, including Koresh, died. More than 20 of them were children, some killed by smoke inhalation and others by falling debris as the fire destroyed the building. Only 9 sect members emerged alive. There have always been questions around those last few hours at Waco. Did the FBI and the Justice Department contribute in some way to that apocalyptic ending by applying too much pressure onto the Davidians, or were they somehow responsible for causing the fire? Independent filmmaker Michael McNulty found a shell casing from a certain type of tear gas round that could have started a fire. That evidence pointed towards the FBI potentially being responsible. The Justice Department had denied using this type of tear gas for more than 6 years, but after pressure from Johnston, who, for several weeks, wrote to his superiors warning them that the new evidence contradicted what they had been saying, Attorney General Janet Reno eventually admitted that the tear gas round had been used. So the FBI was caught in a lie. Though credible experts still overwhelmingly believe the Davidians started the fire, the admission breathed life into conspiracy theories that surround the Waco case. Who actually caused the fire has remained a point of contention, although an independent arson investigation concluded the fire was started from within the building. Another area of contention is who fired the first bullet. Gunfire broke out on the compound when agents arrived with arrest and search warrants. There was evidence that the Davidians were illegally stockpiling weapons. In fact, the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms believed the community had nearly 250 weapons, including semi-automatic rifles, assault rifles, shotguns, revolvers, pistols, and hundreds of grenades. So could the gunfire have started on the inside? Amid the chaos, Koresh called 911 to report the shooting, but a transcript of the call remains inconclusive as to who exactly started firing first. Eyewitness reports are often the best way to find out what really happened. ABC News ran an article earlier this year with statements by some of the 9 survivors of the 1993 tragedy. The tank came into the front doors, the 2 double doors, and they just blew everything back. It was amazing to see a tank come through your living room, said Waco survivor and former Branch Davidian member David Thibodeau, who was inside the compound when the agents stormed the place. Those inside say the tanks destroyed the interior staircases, trapping many on the second floor. Thibodeau says he barely escaped. The wall started to catch fire, and I could feel the heat. It singed the side of my face. I could hear my hair crackle. Former Davidian David Buns said Koresh wouldn't let his own children go, as he believed he was the next Messiah, and so his children were special and born from the message of God. Buns also believed Koresh had started it on purpose to be in control of the situation, but Clive Doyle, another Davidian inside during the siege, said he wasn't sure. I didn't see where it started, or who lit it or didn't light it, whether it was an accident, whether it was deliberate. There were no gas masks for the children, so the parents were soaking towels in buckets of water. One thing's for certain, Waco was a tragedy that no one would want to see repeated. Are you familiar with other apocalyptic cults out there? What do you think drives someone to join a cult in the first place? Let us know your thoughts in the comments. Also, be sure to check out our other video called Most Horrific American Serial Killers. Thanks for watching, and as always, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. See you next time!